Hi, my name's David Gibson and I'm a partner at Short, Richard & Forth. I'm also head of the Fundraising Charities Unit, and over the next couple of minutes I'm going to be looking at an emerging development in relation to fundraising in the charitable sector. It's a key time for charities now to engage with their lawyers and understand exactly what the regulations say so they're totally compliant. Failing to do so can lead to heavy financial penalties, but also, and importantly, an exercise in naming and shaming which could undermine the trust and confidence that you have with those that are giving to your charity. So what's the code all about? Essentially, it's an important step taken by the Fundraising Regulator to ensure that charities are acting in an open, accountable and transparent manner, to ensure that the public have confidence and trust that the money and the donations and the time and the effort and the energy that they're putting in to raise funds for important projects is actually being well spent. The code is essentially about giving cradle to grave protection. So what do I mean by that? Well, from the first point of contact that a charity may have with a member of the public seeking funds, right to the expenditure of the funds raised, the charity must be held to account. This also raises important data protection issues for charities in how they contact members of the public. Some charities are happy to undertake wealth screening or teleappending, which essentially means that they're gathering information from a broad range of sources to target their marketing campaigns. But this raises important data protection issues, and potential breaches of data protection legislation can lead to very heavy fines being levied by the Information Commissioner's Office. Volunteers are the lifeblood of any charity, and the code gives specific guidance as to how charities should be engaging with their volunteers. For example, in relation to door-to-door or street collections, charities must have explicit information on who the person is who's carrying out the charitable fundraising, must have a contact number for them, and have some idea as to the hours where they will be performing those duties. There are certain standards that the volunteers must adhere to as well, and there's the introduction of the three-step rule, i.e. people approaching members of the public on the street can only walk alongside that person for three steps. These standards are imperative in ensuring that the public have confidence in those that are acting as fundraisers for particular charities. Failure to abide by this aspect of the code can lead to the levy of fines and financial sanctions against a charity, and as we've already said, can also lead to naming and shaming. It's therefore imperative that charities ensure that they are training their volunteers on how they should be acting and how they should be engaging with members of the public. Failure to do so is going to lead to problems for a number of charities. A number of charities may actually outsource the fundraising activities, and this can also lead to problems. We've recently seen the example of Neatfeet, who operated in the Bristol area. Unfortunately, Neatfeet employed people who were either criminals or drug addicts or alcoholics to raise funds on behalf of a number of high-profile charities. Complaints were made and the Fundraising Regulator has fully investigated this matter, leading to the naming and shaming not only of Neatfeet, but unfortunately some of the charities for whom they worked. It's therefore very important that charities go through a careful process of due diligence with those fundraising organisations to ensure that they are employing the right people, that those people are fully conversant with the code of practice, and importantly, that that activity is monitored and reviewed. If charities really want to secure their position, they will enter into contractual agreements which make sure and are explicit that those fundraising organisations fully adhere to the code. Social media is obviously a key area for charities in raising funds, and it's imperative that they ensure that their social media policies are fully compliant with the code of practice, that their employees, consultants, freelancers and volunteers are fully aware of social media policies as well, to ensure that there's no abuse. Now, what's also important, that there are key data protection issues. Members of the public don't want to be bombarded by requests via email, text or any Facebook entries. So, what can charities do in a practical way? Number one, they must ensure that there is the option to unsubscribe from any emails. Number two, they must ensure that their particular target market is focused and they're not just sending out scattergun approaches to mail shots. Number three, if somebody wants to unsubscribe, then they should be allowed to unsubscribe, and you must monitor and review how matters are dealt with in terms of requests to unsubscribe. And finally, and most importantly, it's imperative that issues raised by the new fundraising preference service, which is to be launched on the 6th of July 2017, are adhered to. This gives members of the public and those who care for those who are susceptible to give clear indication as to how they want to be approached by charities. It may be a good idea to sign up to the fundraising preference service, and this has been heartily recommended by the Fundraising Regulator. Many charities will use events to raise funds, but has the charity made sure that all health and safety considerations have been addressed at a particular event? Are your fundraising packs compliant with the code? Are you identifying exactly how the money should and will be spent? Have you got a programme and process of accountability to ensure, for example, when somebody is raising money in aid of a particular charity, that those funds are actually transferred to the charity in a timely and responsive manner? If not, again, this can lead to investigation by the fundraising regulator and the naming and shaming of the charity, therefore undermining public confidence even further. So if you're going to do an event, get it right. Do a health and safety check. Ensure the fundraising packs are good. And also ensure that money is transferred to the relevant account and used for that particular purpose in a timely manner. So, in summary, charities face immense challenges. They perform a great service to members of the public in protecting and promoting the rights and interests of often very vulnerable people. But at the same time, there are certain standards by which they must adhere. Failure to adhere to those standards can actually undermine all that good work that's been done, not only over years, but decades. So it's imperative that charities make themselves familiar with the Fundraising Regulator. Follow the Fundraising Regulator on their Twitter account. It's a great source of information. But also make sure that any information that you have is disseminated within your organisation. It's no good a small group of people holding the information and holding it to themselves. It's got to be shared. People have got to be aware of how they can act, when they can act, and the standards that they must adhere to. In many ways, the code is a welcomed opportunity for charities to ensure that public confidence is promoted and preserved in the work that they do, and then they can focus on the real important tasks, essentially helping those for whom they were set up to support. Lawyers can be very dull and dreary tribe at the best of times. So what can we do to actually help you? Number one, we can provide training, practical training, for your board and also for your volunteers, employees, freelancers and other organisations with whom you work to ensure that you're code compliant. Number two, we prepare quarterly newsletters and updates on emerging developments that are impacting on charities. Number three, we can speak to our data protection team, who are experts in advising charities on how to ensure that they're data protection compliant. So, follow us at our website, srflegal.co.uk, or also at our Twitter feed as well, where we'll regularly update you on matters that are relevant to you and to ensure that you are compliant and to ensure also that you can just get on with the good work that you do on a daily basis.